Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Much appreciate it. And thank you also for your patience with while we sort through technical stuff here. So my name is Eric Wall. I am the chair of the San Francisco section of AIAA, which is the American Institute for Aeronautics and Astronautics. And just a couple quick words about who we are. Basically, our mission is we exist to help aerospace professionals and their organizations succeed. And, you know, we have basically about 30,000 members worldwide, number of corporate members, a large number of our members are actually students, and across 91 different countries. And we do actually quite a number of things. You know, basically, we want to help build a diverse and inclusive workforce. We want to help meet tomorrow's workforce demands, enable knowledge transfer, you know, connect people, ideas, and resources, advance people's careers, you know, definitely build up the technical side of things, and establish a united front to solve critical issues in our industry and just, you know, worldwide in general. We do a number of activities that help to support this, both at the national level as well as at the local level, including various things like networking, job fairs and career development, mentoring. We provide scholarships. We help with research and publications. We do public policy advocacy and much more. Specifically, some of the activities that we have going on at this point in time, either right now or in the near future, at a local point of view, we do various tech talks and dinner meetings. We do young professional get-togethers and happy hours. We do outreach at the college and K through 12 level, and we do section honors and awards as well. And of course, we're very happy for anybody to join in on these type of activities that we do, as you know, even if you're not a member, especially for like these tech talks and dinner meetings. But if you become a member, it does prevent allow you to basically get other benefits and help to support the work that we do. One thing in particular I just want to bring up to people's attentions as a save the date sort of thing is our next event that we're going to be doing. It's going to be actually a joint event with the Bay Area Women in Space and Aerospace organization. And it's going to be a happy hour and a panel discussion on the challenges and achievements of women on their way to senior leadership roles in the aerospace industry. This will be happening on March the 1st at 6 p.m. It's going to be a hybrid format. So that means that we will we'll have a place set up that we've reserved in the Mountain View area where people can come and join in person if they'd like to. Otherwise, we also have a virtual option as well for people to join. So whichever way you feel comfortable with joining us, very welcome to do so. And please stay tuned. We will be sending out the official registration for that very shortly. All right. So on to the main event. Please help me welcome our speaker, Scott Truax. Scott has been surrounded by science and technology his whole life. His father was Robert Truax, one of America's pioneers in rocketry. Among many other things, Robert was involved with one of Evel Knievel's famous stunts, which was an attempted canyon jump on a rocket-powered vehicle. Scott himself has had a long history of engineering and fabrication of cars, rockets, and support equipment, as well as having owned a construction company. Along the way, he decided to help recreate Evel Knievel's failed jump with the goal of proving to the world that his father's design would have worked if not for a premature parachute deployment. So please join me as we hear from Scott concerning Robert's work and Scott's own efforts and find out if Robert was ultimately vindicated. Scott, the floor is yours.
Hey everybody! Thanks for stopping by. I hope you find this this talk interesting. Basically, what I did was I've written a book, and my dad wrote a book on his life, and mine was on my life and my journey to recreate Evel's failed attempt. And I kind of culled down all the, got rid of all the personal stuff and really kind of melted it down to the good rockety goodness. And hopefully you guys all like it. So I'm going to, I've got several pictures that we're going to try to share as I'm reading the story and kind of give you an idea of the whole crazy madness that went on in my life, living through all the Evel Knievel stuff and then our whole recreation. So just give me a second while we pull up the pictures here and share them. Sorry, I'm on a computer that's kind of slow, but
And while you're pulling that up, just a quick note to the audience, we will be having a Q&A session afterwards. So the format for that is basically when the presentation is over, please put any questions that you have into the Q&A box specifically. So not the regular chat, but the Q&A box. Thank you.
Okay. Do you see that crazy motorcycle there?
Yep.
All right. So every generation has something that blows its collective mind. The 50s could have called it Elvis, the 60s had the Beatles, and the 70s had Evel Knievel. Evel's crazy jumps and his persona captivated and inspired the entire generation. The most audacious thing he ever tried was to jump a canyon in a rocket. And that story's never been completely told until now. And I feel uniquely qualified because I was in the middle of all this madness surrounding his original jump. And I was inspired to walk in the footsteps of my heroes about 40 years later. It was something that I thought I was destined to do, and it took nearly 10 years to complete. It was frustrating and exasperating at times, and it left me completely penniless, but I wouldn't have changed the experience for the world. And I hope you enjoy hearing about it half as much as I enjoyed living it. So Evel Knievel is a man who, regarding our generation, needs no introduction. He's the alter ego of Robert Craig Knievel, who'd go on to become the most famous motorcycle jumper that the world had ever known. At some point, he realized he needed to up the ante on his motorcycle jumping game, and he decided to jump the Grand Canyon on a motorcycle. Far from a rocket scientist, Evel strapped some Turbonique rocket engines that he had ordered out of the back of a magazine to a Triumph Bonneville and began telling the world that about his Grand Canyon jumping plans. And this is the picture of the contraption that he came up with. So he bought this beta version of his Canyon cycle to all of his jumping events. And eventually it had catched the eye of a young aerospace engineer named Doug Malwicki. Doug approached Evel's manager at the display and said something along the lines of, "I hope you're not going to let Evel try and jump that thing." After explaining his credentials, Evel's manager convinced Doug to give him the contact info so Evel could get a hold of him. One night around 2 a.m., he calls Doug, as Evel was known to do, and asked him who he thought he was to question his amazing rocket-powered motorcycle. After Doug explained who he was, Evel asked him how he would do it. Doug explained that it needed to be more aerodynamic and stable, like a rocket. Doug ended up building a small scale, essentially an Estesized model rocket, which is pictured here, and launched it at one of Evel's events. I highly recommend checking out Doug's site, canosaurus.net, if you want to get the full version of this part of the story. So Evel was impressed enough with Doug and his little rocket to give him some money to build a prototype. He'd go on to build what was called the X-1 Skycycle. In the search for an engine to power the X-1, Doug's travels would end up taking him to Aerojet, where the company quoted him a figure of several hundred thousand dollars for an adequate engine. After Doug recovered from his faint, somebody suggested that he get in touch with Bob Truax, who had built a steam rocket that might fit his budget. And that's where my dad came into the picture. So eventually, whether intentional or unintentional, the press got wind of the X-1 without Evel's consent, and he was furious and he fired Doug. So Evel wrote a letter to my dad asking him to take over the project. And So the my dad agreed, but told Evel that the rocket would need a complete redesign. Evel was adamant with Doug that the Skycycle be more motorcycle than rocket, something he could ride. Because the force of his personality, Doug probably just went along with him. The problem is physics didn't really pan out. It would have been near impossible to stay in control of a motorcycle traveling at nearly 400 miles an hour and then hitting a ramp. So my dad told Evel that the new vehicle was going to need to be more like a pure rocket, starting at the bottom of a 56 degree launch ramp. That's the angle that was necessary to achieve maximum height to allow enough time for the parachute to deploy. So the parachute deployed from the rear, landed on a shock absorber mounted on the nose on the other side of the canyon. Evel didn't like the idea of not being in control of the vehicle, but my dad was able to sell it. My dad was really savvy politically. He told him that he'd be like an astronaut. And the Apollo program was in full swing at the time, and the astronauts were heroes. So I guess Evel liked the sound of that. So my dad went on to take over the project and design a rocket that would be called the X-2 Skycycle. My dad described the vehicles thusly. He says, whereas the X-1 was the Lockheed of the breed, sleek and beautiful, mine was the Grumman, kind of ugly, but rugged as all get out. Fabrication began in our basement. Oh, let's see. Did I show that picture? So fabrication begins in our basement, and it wasn't long before my dad would announce his retirement from the Navy and decided to pack it all up and continue the project in Saratoga, California. That's where the progress really ramped up, and I became aware of the amazing cultural significance of this whole thing. At some point, Evel had called my dad and told him that the decision was made to launch the X-1 for publicity. So all the crew headed to Idaho to launch the sleek and sexy X-1 into the river. There were concerns that the X-1's stability, so he deliberately underloaded the tanks and in the already underpowered vehicle, and it ended up at the bottom of the canyon as expected. So regarding the design of the X-2, my dad preferred to use surplus military parts whenever possible rather than build something from scratch. The fuselage of the X-2 was made from an external fuel tank from a Grumman Albatross seaplane. The engine was made using a breathing oxygen tank from a B-50 bomber. The fins were the tail fins from a Hiller helicopter, and the wheels were off a Cessna 172. The aerodynamic stability was tested by mounting a scale model of the on the end of a 2x4 strapped to the front fender of our 69 Ranchero running down Highway 280. But it was soon discovered that the original configuration was unstable. So he basically started increasing the number and the surface area of the fins until the model flew straight. That's why some of the early press release photos differed from the original design. The Skycycle was powered by a steam engine my dad had developed for a dragster for legendary racer Art Arfons called the Neptune, which was later renamed the Thunderbolt. It was filled with roughly 77 gallons of superheated water, heated by a custom-made external boiler until it reached 468 degrees at 500 PSI. The steam was held and released by a rather novel mechanism. Concerned that a valve capable of opening only halfway meant the potential death of Evel, he wanted a system that was binary, full open or full closed. So he basically had a controlled burst diaphragm. The diaphragm he ended up using was actually two dog food can lids. My mom was a big dog, had a few dogs, and you know, would rescue them and raise them. So we had plenty of dog food can lids laying around. And they were consistent thickness. They had the right diameter, and they happened to fit perfectly in between the nozzle and the extension tube that connected to the rocket engine tank. So they were sandwiched between a male and female cutting dies with a hole in the center, which one end of a hydraulic ram passed through. When the ram was actuated, it pulled the male die through the female die and release the pressure instantly. So it worked like a charm. So two X2s were actually made. The code name, the 711 and the 117. And the idea would be to launch one, the 711. And if it worked, great. We'll build the next one identically. If it didn't, we would incorporate any changes deemed necessary in the 117, and that'd be the one that Evel would fly. At some point, the decision was made to incorporate a rather costly and complicated anti-roll system into the rockets. The fear was that the parachute would get tangled upon deployment if the rocket was rolling too much during flight. It was essentially two small canard fins controlled by a gyroscope salvaged from a Nike missile. It was giving him fits, and my dad found himself waking up at 4 a.m. in a cold sweat. During our project, I came to know that same feeling well. With my dad, you would have never known it, though. I've never seen a guy carry himself with such restraint and dignity over what must have been crippling stress, because that rocket had to launch. They had a deal with a closed circuit. They were showing it on closed circuit in movie theaters, so they had like a 20-minute window. And you know, even NASA gets to scrub a launch if it doesn't work. And my dad absolutely had to launch within a 20-minute window. So by this time, the dirt ramp designed for the X1 at an angle of 20 degrees was now topped with a 108-foot tall, 56-degree steel ramp. And my dad wrote in his book that when Evel saw it, he exclaimed, "My God, it goes straight up." It wasn't as if he wasn't stressing enough over the Snake River Canyon jump before. He definitely was now. So the following is an excerpt from my dad's book explaining the test launch. "During the testing, we encountered a spate of premature parachute releases. Not actual releases, since the chute itself wasn't installed, but electrical impulses were being received by the firing solenoid that would certainly have released the chute while the cycle was still on the ramp. The rocket was equipped with two umbilical cables, one for commands to be sent from the control van to the rocket, and another instrumentation readings to be sent from the rocket to the van. Both cables were to be designed to pull out by lanyards as the rocket began its travel up the ramp. By trial and error, we discovered that if we pulled the instrumentation cable first, no spurious commands were received by the parachute solenoid. 10 times in succession, we tested the scheme, and it worked every time. We decided to proceed to pull the instrumentation cable manually prior to launch. We later decided that when the instrumentation cables were pulled, the gauge needles returned to zero under spring action, and the current generated by the needle coils was a significant impulse to trigger the parachute release. A very subtle effect that they never thought would be sufficient to release the chute, so they didn't bother to check or even calculate for it. As a part of our preparations, we had several dress rehearsals, including a few exercises in which Knievel simulated an emergency bailout of the Skycycle. Somehow he was never able to develop a sense of urgency. The best he could do was 7 seconds. Ron Chase could do it in 4. We figured that in a real emergency, Knievel could do it as well, and 4 seconds would be fast enough. Finally, we loaded our anthropomorphic dummy, Good Galahad, substituting for Evel, into the Skycycle and through the launch switch. The rocket roared up the ramp, but immediately we knew that something had gone wrong. The parachute had deployed almost instantly. Nonetheless, the Skycycle continued to run hot, straight, and true, as the torpedo men say. Until the parachute blossomed fully and the vehicle came to a screeching halt as the thrust ceased at the same time, the autopilot kept the rocket upright and the vehicle gently nosed over and descended into the canyon, plunging into the river near the far bank with its nose probe securely stuck into the mud. The tail and even the cockpit were sticking out of the water. Good Galahad was uninjured." Well, what to do? Less than a month before the launch, and a cause needed to be determined for the premature parachute deployment, and a redesign was required before they could launch the rocket carrying Evel. Sadly, due to time and budgetary constraints, the rocket was not able to be captive fired with the parachute installed, as they were worried that their only parachute would somehow get damaged. With time breathing down their necks and no money in the budget for another test, they reached the conclusion that even premature deployment was due to an errant electrical signal from the gyro-operated parachute release mechanism. So the decision was made to trash the entire system and install a pair of foot pedals that Evel would use for roll control. All that time, money, and hardware was now for naught. Also, instead of the gyro-controlled chute deployment system, they rigged up a dead man's lever. It was basically a spring-loaded handle that would deploy the parachute as soon as Evel let it go. The idea that even if Evel passed out, he'd let go of the handle, the chute would deploy, and though he might end up in the water, he wouldn't be in a crater on the other side. Hold on, I got a picture. Picture 7. Well, picture 7 seems to have disappeared. Oh, wait. Yeah. Sorry about that. So fast forward to launch day. Evel has a giant crane swing him over the crowd and lower him into the rocket. And as they strap him in, they notice there's a problem. He had two custom jumpsuits made for the rocket ride. The proper one had D-rings sewn into the safety harness, and Evel had soiled it. Apparently, he had spilled mustard on it while eating a hot dog. And ever image conscious, not wanting to appear in front of the minions in a jumpsuit with a big yellow stain on it, he put on the other jumpsuit, the one that had D-rings sewn into the wrong place. And the result was the harness didn't fit properly, it being way too tight. But undeterred, they strapped him in, his right hand on the dead man's lever, left hand grabbing the webbing under the seat, and his feet on the pedals, ready to go. They countdown commenced from 10, and when they reached 1, boom, the rocket took off with a thunderous roar, like a rocket. Almost immediately, a problem could be seen. Apparently, the fix they had come up with for the premature release of the parachute had not worked. Either that, or Evel had let go of the handle immediately after hitting the launch button. The rocket got to what appeared to be almost all the way across, dragging the chute, and when the thrust was depleted, at nearly the same time, the chute was fully deployed. His forward progress ceased, and abruptly, the rocket swung down, pointing directly into the river. Even from the edge of the canyon, you could see Evel struggling inside the cockpit as the ship was going down. And I was at the launch. I was 6 years old, and I was sitting on the top of an RV, and I headed down to see what everyone else wanted to see. And once he went into the canyon, nobody knew what was happening to him. Was he drowning in the river? Did he end up on, you know, one side? And I remember my mom screaming in the background as I jumped into a crowd of sweaty bikers to get a better look. And of course, everybody was worried that there was just this janky chain link fence holding, you know, the crowd of thousands back, but luckily they didn't end up like lemmings and falling into the bottom of the canyon. But there was a pretty strong headwind that blew Evel all the way back, almost at the edge of the this side of the canyon. And there was a very tense 10 minutes or so when nobody knew what was going on. You know, was he drowning in the river? Did he crash in the rocks? So I headed back to the RV since I couldn't see anything. And upon returning, my mom proceeded to scold me for running off how I did. But, you know, what was I supposed to do? I was like everybody else. I wanted to see what was going on. But eventually, a voice came over the loudspeaker. Evel's alive, and he's in the boat and waving. They had a little flat-bottom boat that had picked him up. And after that, they brought him up. And Wide World of Sports reporter Jules Bergman caught up with my dad soon after to get his thoughts. And my dad said, we should have run one more test. So my dad's post-launch examination of the cause was as follows. This is out of his book. He says, after examining all the evidence, I concluded that the problem was caused by oil canning of the canister cover. This allowed the cover to move aft of the exit nozzle, and when the nozzle plug was withdrawn rearward, the shock wave off the forward end deflected the steam under the cover and literally blew the parachute cover off. The parachute system was designed so when the cover came off, it caused the drogue chute to be pulled, and the action of the drogue chute being pulled after 2 seconds caused the main chute to come out. So because of the difficulty holding on to the rather light skin of the Skycycle under 5,000 pounds of thrust, they'd done all their testing with the chute canister removed and with the restraint attached directly to the flange of the nozzle. As a result, we never had done a static firing of the engine with the parachute attached. Had they done so, I'm sure the nature of the problem would have been immediately obvious. At least our last minute failures were pretty sophisticated ones that very few people would have foreseen. You know, so there you go. Whose fault was it? Was it my dad's for not more closely overseeing the parachute design cover, or was it Evel's fault for not providing enough time or money to conduct the proper testing that my dad had wanted? You know, that's for anybody can make that decision for themselves. My guess is anybody that wants to place blame, though, has never done anything innovative, inspirational, or groundbreaking. Sometimes shit happens. So my entire life, it had always bothered me that my brilliant rocket scientist father was most famously known for this rocket that didn't work. So in 2008, I would get an email from my buddy Dezier Molnar that would set in motion my opportunity to show the world that my dad's rocket would have worked. So Dezier was contacted by a guy who was looking for someone to build him a rocket so he could successfully recreate Evel's Snake River Canyon jump. And the guy called himself Mad Mike Hughes. You might have heard of Mad Mike. He's the flat earther guy that launched himself in a rocket out in the California desert and died when his chute failed to deploy. I ended up calling Mad Mike, and my engineer buddy Craig and Adams and I set up a meeting with him. And it wasn't long into the meeting that we realized that Mike was a little off his rocker. He was a limo driver, and he wanted to call the rocket the X-2 Sky Limo. He wanted to make a bunch of unnecessary changes to the X-2 design, which would have made it unrecognizable from the one my dad designed. And in the weeks following the meeting, Mike would send me emails asking for the design details and of the original rocket and press me for a price to build him one. I finally put together what I felt was a realistic price for the whole project, a $750,000. And Mike nearly went apeshit, saying it should have only cost $20,000 because he only wanted us to build a rocket motor. But that's not what he asked for at first. And there was no way I was going to build a steam rocket engine for $20,000. And B, there's no way I would trust a guy like him to integrate it into a rocket without killing people. So that was the point where we stepped away from dealing with Mad Mike. However, the idea of jumping the canyon continued to gnaw away. It was always something that my engineer buddy Craig and I had, you know, wanted to do ever since we were kids. So after a few false starts that I talk about in my book, eventually I was contacted by a Hollywood stuntman who was willing to fund the whole project. And Craig and I set off to make it happen. So we're able to find like the last Grumman Albatross fuel tanks in existence and a couple of B-50 breathing oxygen tanks. And we were off to the races. So I just posted, this came up on Facebook, my Facebook memories of, so this was the original tanks that we used to build what we came to call the Evel Spirit. There was the drop tanks, and there was this, what became the engine tanks. So So then we headed off to Niagara Falls, Canada, where the original test rocket was on display in an Evel Knievel museum. And the owner was Mark DeMarco, was really accommodating. He let us spend the entire day poring over the rocket and measuring every nut, bolt, and rivet on it. So Craig and I put together a set of working drawings and we set off building what we ended up calling the Evel Spirit. Eventually, we were able to secure enough parts to build three rockets. So let me give you some pictures of what early Evel Spirit looked like. So this is the very first picture once we knocked all the dents out of the nose cone and set forth at sanding it and, you know, cut the hole for the pilot in the cockpit. Then we got like a, oh, there we go. That was laid out on our shop floor. And then Craig came up with a really ingenious way of aligning the nozzle and the engine. He built this, we built this fixture. Let me see if I can, there we go. That, you know, really solid steel welding fixture. We had the nozzle machined out of a solid billet of aluminum. And then here's another picture. There's Craig. We had a Harbor Freight motorcycle jack that we used as our stand for working on it. So the idea was that, like my dad, we'd build a test rocket and a flight rocket. And then we ended up basically building another one for good measure. So we had kind of three rockets in different stages of completion at any given time. And we kept as true as we could to the original design with just a few minor changes for safety. One of the changes was Evel's rocket got pretty bashed up on landing. The shock absorber of the original rocket was a lift strut from the cargo door of an airplane. I don't know which one. And we built a significantly beefier one. So here is the structure. There's the structure of the nose. You can see here, this held the shock absorber. There's the tire. Let's see if I can. Nope, I can't bring it down anymore. Oh, there we go. We had our laser alignment fixture to make sure that everything was straight and true. So we early on scrapped the idea of the anti-roll system, as that was the most expensive and complicated part on the original that ended up getting scrapped anyway. We ended up putting the canard fins on the front just for looks. To verify that the center of thrust was in line with the center of the rocket, we did what we called a hang test. And basically what we did was we built this plug that perfectly centered the right in the middle of the nozzle, and we pulled it up. And then on the floor of the shop where we did this, we built a kind of a bullseye. And once we got, I actually got in the rocket to simulate the mass of the pilot, and it pointed exactly straight where it was supposed to. So it was, needless to say, my dad was worried that, you know, it would get into a roll and tangle the parachute. And we were confident enough in our manufacturing that, that it would fly pretty straight. So the only major deviation we made, obviously, was the parachute. The original chute was packed in the rear, and then a backup chute Evel had worn on him. And we figured, even though Evel tested that, you know, they tested that he could get out in 4 seconds, we tried with our harness and our, we actually had a racing seat that was like a NASCAR racing seat, and we couldn't get out it fast enough. And also, once you got out at 400 miles an hour, you've got a vertical fin right behind you, which would cut you in half. So we made the decision that we would put the parachute and the backup chute on in the back of the rocket. And so we came, found a guy named John Dunham, who had a company called Second Chance Aviation that had fitted ballistic recovery chutes for light sport aircraft. And we got together and we discussed the entire system. And what we came up with, I believe, was pretty ingenious, is there was a total of three chutes to be operated independently and deployed with red, white, and blue handles. And I have a picture of the cockpit with the handles. There we go. So that's what the evil spirit looked like. Another thing that we came up with was that the evil had mentioned all there was to hold on to was the webbing under the seat. And we thought that there needs to be a more solid, solid handle. So these handles here were, they were actually forklift control handles, and we modified them to fit, and it was much more secure. So the first chute, hold on a second. So the red handle on the top would deploy the drogue chute, and that would slow the rocket from roughly 400 miles an hour to roughly 200 miles an hour. And that was the speed that the main chute was designed to be deployed at. Then the white handle would be pulled about 5 seconds later to deploy the main chute. And if all went well, that would be it. If something were to go wrong, there was the backup chute, that'd be the blue handle. And the deployment mechanism was a little compressed air rocket that pulled the chute out. So if something were to go wrong with the main chute, let's say it got tangled or something, a backup chute deployment rocket was mounted in a tube at an angle, which would basically deploy it and swing around the back, even if the main chute was deployed, but maybe fouled in some way. So we could have brought it down with two chutes if necessary. Another upgrade we made was to the boiler. My dad custom made a boiler, and it was fraught with issues, mostly leaks, and it took a long time to heat the water up. So Craig had the genius idea to use a modified steam cleaner. So he was able to find a company called Spartan Manufacturing who was willing to modify one of theirs to better suit our needs. We modified it further by putting a variable speed controller on the pump to more accurately control the flow of the water. And it ended up working perfectly. So by November of 2014, we were ready for the test launch. We bought a Grumman box van as our mobile command center, and we had it painted very similar to the one that my dad had used for Evel's launch. And a local trailer company had loaned us a nice aluminum trailer that we fitted with a little cradle so we could use it to tow with the super van to the launch ramp. The ramp itself had kind of an interesting story. I had a drawing for the original ramp, and it utilized several pieces of steel channel welded together to make a 108 foot long, 56 degree pathway with a slot up the center that would guide the rocket as it traveled up. The drawing called for continuous welds on this 18 foot length of channel. And Craig and I and the fabricators were concerned that continuous welds of that length would severely warp the ramp. So we built a little practice section, and sure enough, it was like a banana. It was all warped. And we wanted to stay true to the original design, but we asked the steel company, what would they do? And they said that they'd weld two pieces of a quarter inch flat stock, 50 foot long, to some rectangular structural tubing. So we gave him the go ahead. We figured nobody would care about the difference. And as fate would have it, about a week later, Craig and I were at a local tool company buying tools. And the clerk who knew about our project said, "Hey, my boss has that slider thing that was on Evel's rocket." We were like, "Slider thing? What is that?" And we were thinking, was that the pieces at the bottom of the rocket that guided it up the slot? And we had no idea. Those pieces were missing off the rocket in Canada. So we immediately set up an appointment with his boss, who was working at a shop in Buell, a couple towns over. It turns out what he had was the last remaining section of the original ramp, Evel's original ramp, still with the red paint on it. And surprise, surprise, the weld was staggered. And that's why it was straight. But anyway, the mystery was solved. But back to the test launch. So we loaded the rocket onto the ramp with an off-road forklift. I got a picture of that. I thought I had a picture of that. Oh yeah, there we go. So there's a shot of the rocket before it was paid in getting loaded onto the ramp. You can see the initiator is the thing that pulls the dog food can lids and lets out all the pressure. So we secured the rocket to the ramp with this huge chain and the hydraulic rig that severed the dog food can lids that we call the initiator. Craig wanted to make sure that the rocket pulled away from the initiator cleanly. So we made this sturdy bracket about a foot forward of the rocket that the shock absorber would bump into to keep it from actually launching. And we called that the bump stop. And we ran a series of static tests, bumping up the temperature and pressure each time. At about 350 PSI, the rocket hit the bump stop with such force that it bent the hell out of it. So we had to make a stronger gusseted version. And then at 500 PSI, that test was really violent. We measured the force applied to the shock absorber, and we were able to estimate 6,000 pounds of thrust, and ended up bending the hell out of our new bump stop. But the next step was to get a dummy and simulate the weight of the pilot. And I had no idea what to use with a crash test dummy or, you know, but I thought something like the dummy from the show Mythbusters, Buster. So I actually called Jamie Heineman from Mythbusters, and I was amazed. He answered my email right away, but says that, you know, they didn't want to let Buster go. But he told me that Buster was called a simulade, and it's a dummy that fire departments train with to represent carrying a person who is incapacitated. So the local fire department was nice enough to loan us theirs, and I filled it full of weights that I scavenged from local secondhand stores until he weighed as much as the pilot. So rather than good Galahad, we called our little guy here autopilot. So we were finally ready for the test launch, and the boiler took about 4 hours to get the rocket up to temperature and pressure. So we decided to hold the rocket at temperature and pressure and let it soak to see if the heat would affect the temperature of the parachutes. But it turned out to be within operating temperature. So Craig fired up the boiler again, brought it back up to temperature and pressure. And once we were back to 500 PSI, Craig took his position across the canyon at the landing site. And when he told me over the walkie-talkie that he was ready, we started the obligatory 10 count. And when we reached one, I hit the initiator and there was immediate roar from the rocket. And I ran out of the super van. And my eyes followed the steam trail up till I found the rocket, and it had left the ramp successfully. And other than a slight clockwise roll, seemed to be flying straight and true. There was up to that point a question in our mind. We ran a simulation saying that it was borderline stable. And, you know, we added extra weight to the rear with the parachute. So we weren't 100% sure that it was going to be stable. But anyway, that first launch showed that, yeah, it was stable. And after it reaches apogee, it starts really screaming. And I knew that the drogue chute should have deployed. And just as I am about to have a heart attack, bang, the main chute comes out. And I knew something was kind of weird because it landed kind of fast. So I jumped in my car and ran to the landing zone. And that is what the rocket looked like when it landed. It was stuck like a giant lawn dart. So Craig told me that the main chute failed to deploy. The backup chute, not having a drogue chute to slow it down, had come out at a faster speed than it was designed to, and it ripped a little bit when it was deployed. So it came in faster than it should have. One of the farmhands that had seen the launch was nice enough to bring a shovel so we could dig it out. And as it turned out, the smash, no other than a smashed nose cone and a bent shock absorber, the test rocket was none the worse for wear. So that's what the rocket looked like after we had to cut the shock absorber and nose cone off. But we had two backup rockets, so fully expecting that the test rocket to be damaged beyond repair. But we made the call right there to repair it and fly the original one, having it just proved itself. Further examination determined that the main chute failed to deploy because the actuator, which had been triggered, needed about another eighth inch of travel to pull the pin on the little compressed air rocket to deploy the main chute. So having proving that not only was the rocket stable, but the pilot would have most likely survived the landing with just the backup chute. So it was actually kind of a successful worst case scenario test. So that was November of 2014, and all of 2015 was spent trying to secure sponsors for a TV deal. We had several that came and went, and finally the decision was made on September 16th, 2016. We had a newly repaired and painted sparkling, beautiful red, white, and blue Evel Spirit that was ready to launch. So that was the beautiful test rocket with the new paint job on it. And yeah, I thought they did a great job. Troy Lee Designs actually painted it and got PPG to pay for the paint. So it ended up not costing us anything. And I think he knocked it out of the park with, and it's gotta be a record for the prettiest rocket ever built. So we didn't have a budget for insurance to cover spectators. So we let it slip that we were launching on a Saturday and ended up launching on a Friday instead, hoping that would keep spectators to a minimum. Despite our little trick, a few hundred people ended up showing up, and liftoff was about 3 o'clock. I was about to send a guy to his death or to glory. And this time we ditched the test 10 count for a 5 count. Actually here, here's a, of course I had to sit in the thing on the ramp, and anybody who thinks it was an easy spam in a can cakewalk has never sat in this little 25 inch diameter aluminum tube pointed skyward. You know, it was terrifying just to sit in it. There's what it looked like on the ramp just before launch. So we ditched the 10 count for a 5 count. Everyone got in their positions. And this time the initiator duties were with the pilot. So I switched that over, and a nanosecond later, after I said one, there was that familiar thunderous roar again, and I jumped to my feet and I gave a quick glance to my left out the driver's window to verify the rocket had cleared the ramp, and I dashed out the front door. And this time The rocket was obscured by the cloud of steam backlit by the sun. So that was the launch of the Evel Spirit. I had to wait till the rocket had descended below the steam cloud to see it. And I'll tell you, time, when they say time slows down in times of stress, that was definitely what happened. I heard a voice coming over the walkie-talkie, pull, 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 signaling that the rocket had reached apogee and it was time to pull the drogue chute. And the steam lingered over my vantage point, so it was hard to see, but I heard people clapping and cheering, and I thought, well, that didn't give me immediate relief, because I remember when the Space Shuttle Challenger exploded, people were cheering, unaware of what had just taken place. So I had spotted that finally when I saw it screaming towards the Earth with the drogue chute, it seemed lower, and just when I was about to pee my pants, thought my heart would explode, the main chute deployed and unfurled in red, white, and blue, all of its star-spangled glory. So I jumped in, headed for my car, but someone had moved it, and I shouted to the crowd if somebody could give me a ride to the landing zone. And actually, the guy that had leased us the property gave me a ride to the other side. And when I finally found the spot where it had landed, I was surprised to see it sitting on its wheels. I expected to see it stuck in the ground like before, but the difference was the test launch was in November after a few rains and the ground was nice and soft. So this time we had actually locked the shock absorber firmly in place, thinking most of the shock absorbing the ground was going to do. But what it ended up doing, it came in at a slight angle, hit the ground, pirouetted around, landed perfectly on its wheels. It was the absolute perfect, perfect landing. We couldn't have hoped for anything better. So the telemetry said that it had gone 411 miles an hour, 2,413 feet altitude, and 3,748 feet downrange. So that was it. That was the culmination of almost 10 years of craziness. I got a couple more pictures. This is my favorite picture of all time. This is, hold on. Let me see if I can widen this. So there's my dad, there's me, and this is my half-sister, half-brother, half-sister's husband and their kids, my nieces and nephews, and they have my dad in the rocket. And let's see, if do I have any other pictures here? So here's a shot of the inside of the rocket looking back. Here's the rocket engine and all the insulation that we had. Here's some of the chromoly structure. Here's a good one. So this was the parachute remote deployment mechanism. So this is the power window motor from some model Toyota, and it was actuated by a garage door opener, a high-end one that had a long-distance signal that actuated instead of a window crank, we had a little lever that pulled the pin on the ballistic rocket that pulled the chute out. That's kind of it. And I am willing to take any questions that anybody might have. We can go back to regular mode, regular video mode. Eric, if you're there.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's take you. There we go. All right. So let's see. I can, if you can see the Q&A box, feel free to just answer directly, or I can read them off either way.
Five questions. Let's see. Yep. My friend Tommy was there. He, one of the best things about the whole project was meeting this and becoming a part of this Evel Knievel community. So many people that had grown up with Evel Knievel, and, you know, we all bought into that, you know, message that he had of, if you can dream it, you can do it. And my friend Tommy, actually a guy that grew up not far from me, and you know, now we're a really good friend. So, hey Cameron, you don't have to say on here, but I was wondering where you had where I had Todd's ashes. Okay, so one of the guys that I had met, my first introduction to the Evel fans were in Butte, Montana, Evel's hometown. There was Evel Knievel Days. That was like every summer. I think it was late July. And all these Evel fans would come, and it was just a, you know, weekend long party in the streets celebrating Evel's life. And I met a guy named Todd Swayze, who was just one of these guys. He was big Evel Knievel fan, Canadian guy that would come down from Canada every year. And before the launch, he ended up passing away of cancer. And we thought it would be a cool gesture to take some of his ashes. And Eddie Braun, who was the guy that piloted the rocket, took a little sample of his ashes on his, you know, wear it in his jumpsuit across the canyon. So, and do I think that the bird design hit a max distance and speed, or do I think it had more? I don't, maximum from what? I'm sure that it was faster than, you know, it was every bit as fast as Evel's rocket, of course faster because it didn't have a parachute dragging behind it. I would think the FAA would consider this an aircraft. Did that issue come up? Yeah, surprisingly, the FAA didn't really care. They said, contact the local airport, which we did, and told them, we weren't really that close to the airport anyway, and told them what we were doing. They said, okay. I mean, I think it's technically illegal by model rocket standards to launch a metal model rocket. So yeah, nobody really cared. Even Mad Mike, the guy that killed himself, didn't seem to have any issues launching his rocket. So, you know, that was kind of cool. Would you do it again with a GoPro or something similar? Oh, so anonymous attendee, there is a movie called Stuntman that is available on Disney Plus that talks about the whole jump from the pilot's perspective. And they're, you know, if you don't care about any of that, you can fast forward to the end. It's on Disney Plus. Definitely worth the cost of admission for the jump footage, because we had cameras mounted all over the thing, and the footage is amazing. So, are you going to build more rockets? I don't know. I tell you, I would love to build. Evel originally wanted to jump the Grand Canyon. And if there was any, I suppose, any money in it, because we all, it was a labor of love. You know, we had all kind of hoped that, you know, there would be some kind of, you know, payout at the end, but no, it was definitely a labor of love, and I'm not willing to do it again for free. So, yes, Tommy, it landed, 3/4 of a mile downrange, and which was, you know, every bit as far, if not farther than we had expected. Okay. Cameron clarifies this question. Do I think an Evel spirit can go even faster and farther? No, I think we did the maximum with what we had. If I were to do it over again, I believe we could lighten it up a bit and, you know, change the fin configuration and probably get more performance. But, you know, at some point, you know, you can just put a jet engine in it and fly as far as you want. So, so I think that is all the questions.
Yeah. So if you don't mind, actually, I'm going to interject with a couple of my own that I had.
Okay.
So number one, I was just wondering if you could say a few words actually about how you met the guy who ended up piloting it.
Yeah. So by the way, I tried to boil this down into technical stuff. There is my dad's life story that is available. If you contact me on Facebook, it's on Amazon called American Rocket Man. But if you want to buy it from me directly, I have a Facebook page called Max Q Truax, spelled with two X's. So friend me on Facebook, send me a message, and I can ship you out my book or my dad's book. Both tell the whole history. One tells the history of me. One tells the history of my dad. And there's some pretty good personal stories. But yeah, I had started out. I didn't figure I was good enough at marketing to sell the idea to get someone else to pay for it. So we had just basically done what we call the field of dreams approach. If you build it, they'll come. You know, at the point where you saw the shop with the kind of crusty looking rocket, you know, once I got the rocket looking like a rocket, I started a Facebook page called Return to Snake River. And like 3 days later, I get an email from this Hollywood stuntman that said he was inspired by Evel Knievel to be a stuntman. And that's what he had done his whole life. And that he wanted to pilot the rocket and ended up bankrolling the whole thing. So that is that's the story of, you know, how we ended up paying for the whole thing. A random Facebook message. So Steve Yeager, I noticed you started the project a couple of years before your dad died. What was his take on it? Yeah, that was actually, my dad passed away in 2010. I had hoped to have this. So I had, my book goes into detail on the drama and the craziness leading up to this. But yeah, I'd hoped to bring my dad on as a consultant, and boy, that would have been great for him to see it before he passed away. But unfortunately, you know, we couldn't get the planets to align and make that happen. So, yeah, that's, you said you had some other questions.
Yeah. One other question. So you said that you ended up effectively building three, rockets.
Yeah.
What ended up happening to them?
So the guy that flew the rocket asked me if I minded a consultant being brought on. And he said he's worked with this guy named Kai Michelson before. And I'm like, oh, I know Kai through reputation well. If I wasn't going to build the rocket myself, I'd have Kai build it. And so he came on and we became good friends. And Kai and his friend Kurt Anderson ended up buying all of the surplus material. And so we had two rockets, kind of pieces that were, you know, under construction. Kai ended up finishing it and he sort of put his own stank on it, and he's got it in his museum at his house. So I highly recommend anybody that's that doesn't know Kai, look up Kai Michelson on Facebook. He has this a finished Evel Spirit in his rocket museum at his house.
Be cool.
Cameron, did you find the Twin Falls people embrace you more now that you were successful? Yeah, that's funny. Twin Falls has a kind of a love-hate relationship with the rocket. The old school people that were there during Evel's time, half of them, the younger people thought it was really cool. The older people saw all the crazy bikers that came in and kind of trashed the place and had a, you know, never again, not in my backyard take on it. there were a lot of people that thought that they should have been able to come out and see it, which I get, but we didn't have a budget for it. We couldn't put on an event there. So, you know, like I said, it was a labor of love. We ended up launching kind of for ourselves.
All right, great. Last call for any questions.
Well, cool. Oh, one more. Tommy says one of the best days of his life seeing it live. Yeah. Tommy was one of the guys that, you know, we kept it under wraps, but there were a few hardcore fans, like a bunch of guys from England that were Evel Knievel fans that they wanted to come over and see it. And I kind of let that slip. And Tommy had actually, you know, there was no money in, there was no budget even to pay me during the final, like 3 months of getting the rocket ready to launch. And Tommy, among a few other people, had kind of helped me out so I could, you know, have launched the thing. Steve grew up in Boise, 100 miles away. He begged my dad to go. Yeah, no, it's probably not a bad idea, because it was kind of a crazy day. You're welcome, Cameron. Yeah, I see Cameron all the time on Facebook. He's like one of the most world-renowned Evel Knievel fans. Good guy. All the Evel Knievel fans are great, great people. I never met a bad one, I think. Oh, Will Bolton. You're welcome. Watch the original on TV. Good to hear more background. Yeah, and like I said, if anybody's interested in finding out about the crazy story of, you know, how I started this whole thing, there's a lot of human details that I left out. I'm gearing this more towards the you know, rocket, hardcore rocket nerds. And my dad certainly has more of an incredible story than than I do. You know, he basically was a self-made rocket scientist that grew up in a log cabin. You know, he was born in 1917, and he saw everything from, you know, the Model T to the space shuttle to SpaceX. So his life is incredible. And, you know, if you want to know more about it, American Rocket Man, and my book is Return to Snake River. You can contact me on Facebook again, Max Q Truax, two X's, and I can sell you either book, sign them, or you can buy them on Amazon. Oh, Michael Myrick, feel familiar name. You're welcome. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Scott. We really appreciate you being here and sharing with us. And thank you, everybody else, for joining. If you would, you know, like to keep in touch with us, please feel free. Keep an eye on our website. We'll also send out any notifications of upcoming events and so on. And that's it for the evening. So thank you again, Scott.
Thank you. Take care.
Everyone have a good evening. Cheers.